in a town where high winds can be a severe problem. All this to solve a common blight, inner city decay.
In the mid-60s, American cities were very troubled. There was poverty, there was crime, there were race riots, there was a lot of worry about whether or not they could even survive. New York was troubled. There was a lot of worry about New York's future.
It was decided that a rundown area known as Radio Row should be demolished and replaced with a high-technology landmark building, something rather more fitting for a country that was about to embark on the space race.
It was a classic American response to a problem, which is hit it right down the middle with as much firepower as you can give it. 210-story boxes, the tallest towers in the world, well, that was going to fix everything, right? That's how we thought in the 1960s.
Back then, the man in charge was Guy Tozzoli, who 35 years later saw the towers fall as he drove to work.
Honestly, I never thought the towers would collapse. It just never occurred to me. They had 170 when we opened, and it just didn't seem possible. I remember I cried, sitting in the car.
In happier times, Mr. T, as he was known to his staff, was put in charge of what the Reader's Digest called the biggest building project since the pyramids.
My job was to make a program which the architects would follow. How many feet of office space, how many feet of consumer service area, a place for customs, a hotel, and then to find the architectural team that could carry it out.
The architect was to be Minoru Yamasaki, or Yama as he was known, a Japanese-American who died in 1986. He conceived of a pair of 80-story towers sprouting from a huge open plaza. But even these giants would not have enough office space for Mr. T.
I said, well, does it meet our program? No, he said, it's not. It's 2 million square feet short. Well, I said, why is that? Well, he said, you can't build a building taller than 80 floors. And I said, why? Well, he said, because the elevatoring and buildings taller than 80 floors make it impossible to be rentable.
The problem was that with a building over 80 stories tall, so much of the lower floors are taken up with the elevators needed to service the upper floors that the building becomes uneconomic. But this little problem wasn't going to stop Guy Tozzoli.
And I remember saying to Yama, Yama, President Kennedy is going to put a man on the moon. I think you could build us the tallest buildings in the world.
The way the problem was solved was to treat each third of the skyscraper as a separate 40-story building, so that fewer elevator shafts would be needed. This pattern was repeated 3 times, and the whole system was linked together with 2 express elevators that were the only ones that would go the whole height of the building.
If you went to an upper floor of the World Trade Center, you didn't get in the elevator at the ground floor and go to your floor. You got into a big, giant elevator that was an express to what was called a sky lobby, and there you switched for a local elevator to your individual floor. That's what they did, and that's how the buildings happened.
Solving the elevator problem meant that it was now possible to build on an unprecedented scale, to construct towers that would eventually become synonymous with America itself.
We were constructing a building which put up high in the air a huge amount of rentable space, much more so than any building in the past, or indeed any building today. In order to do that, we had to rethink the whole process of designing and the technology that went into the design.
It quickly became clear that New York's occasional 100-mile-an-hour winds would be the dominant factor.
The lateral push of the wind on the World Trade Center is perhaps 4 or 5 times larger than the earthquake load would be if you build it in Los Angeles or in Tokyo.
Such a vast building would be blown about in the wind, and it would not only lean backwards, a dangerous side-to-side oscillation could occur. For the first time, a wind tunnel was used to analyze the movement of the buildings in hurricane-force winds. And it showed that if they were not correctly designed, the towers would shake themselves to pieces.
We had to think about the dynamics of the motion of the building, not just the fact that it leaned a little bit in the wind.
The solution was to make the building of high-strength steel concentrated in the exterior walls, a unique and dramatic departure from conventional skyscraper design.
Most skyscrapers are built on steel or concrete frames, which is a grid of columns and beams that goes all the way through the building. The World Trade Center was different. It was what engineers call a tube structure. It was a very, very strong mesh of steel that surrounded the exterior.
The way in which these walls were built was equally ingenious. 3 30-foot long columns were welded together off-site to make a relatively lightweight yet rigid prefabricated panel. This was then hoisted up to join thousands of similar pieces, forming a massively strong wall of steel. In the middle stood a steel core, which would contain all the stairwells and the elevators, giving the towers one of their major selling points, large open floor spaces.
Tenants like open space. It's flexible. It allows them to have big open rooms if they want, or to put temporary partitions anywhere they please.
There was another advantage to this system. It would save money.
You could do a tube structure with roughly half the amount of steel than you would need for a conventional frame that goes all the way through the structure, but it would hold up just as well, it would be just as strong.
The end result was a building of extraordinary structural efficiency. Hundreds of acres of office space held high in the sky by the clever use of steel. Steel that now lies in a scrapyard, and which contains the secret of how this revolutionary design was undone.
Hyundai's new range of powerful common rail diesel engines squeeze every last drop of energy from every last drop of fuel. Relax and chill out to the classic Chill Out album. Over 2 hours of pure indulgence. The ultimate collection of classics for a modern world, featuring Ennio Morricone, Moby, William Orbit, and many more. Stay cool with the classic Chill Out album, out now.
She had beautiful, long, golden hair all over her body. Then one day, I catch her in another guy's basket. I wasn't going to argue. He was a boxer.
All she said was, "What'd you expect? I'm a bitch."
I guess some folks just got no breeding. But hey, that's life. That's all the people say.
If Smirnoff made pet food.
First there were Cadbury chocolate fingers. Now there's new mini fingers. Sorry, thumbs. It's a mini finger thing.
Nick, didn't expect you back for ages. I heard you were dying of flu.
I was. More to the point, what are you doing with this?
Well, pal, with you not around, the merger was going to go down a pan, wasn't it?
Actually, pal, it wasn't. It's sorted. I spoke to them yesterday. They're signing today.
But you were ill. How come?
Lemsip Max Strength. This sorts the men from the boys.
Lemsip Max Strength. Hardworking medicine because life doesn't stop.
Kodak EasyShare digital camera and dock. Transfer at the touch of a button and your pictures are ready to email or print. It's digital photography made simple.
The World Trade Center was built at an amazing rate, 3 floors every 2 weeks. Steel came from all over America and beyond, arriving just in time to be hoisted to its new home in the sky. Efficiency was the buzzword, and in charge of the project was an extremely busy Guy Tozzoli.
Well, the first thing I did is I scheduled meetings of 17 minutes. That was the maximum you could have my time. And I took it religiously that way. And you got an answer. That was very important. Because if anything was delayed, $1 million a day to stop this project. And it had to be done on time.
Every aspect was optimized in order to save weight and therefore cost. The steel varied in strength and thickness from tower to tower, since as a pair, the buildings would shelter each other slightly from the wind.
The two towers are different. They're different in many ways, and to me, they are not twins. They were. Oh, I have that problem. Present tense, past tense. They were different, and I thought of them that way. I always thought of them as together, that is, brother and sister, or two brothers and whatever, or two sisters, but not as twins. I always thought of them as different.
The final job was to place a 350-ton TV antenna on the top of the North Tower, taking its total height to 1,719 feet. But already the winds of architectural fashion had changed, and the towers were harshly received by the critics.
They were all but ignored by the architecture community, except to sneer at them from time to time. And I remember saying that they were just utterly banal, and how sad it was that the biggest buildings in New York were the dullest.
It's hard to be down when you're up.
Observation deck at the top of the World Trade Center. If you think the view from inside is spectacular, wait till you get outside to the roof. It's breathtaking.
Architects may not have liked them, but they were a hit with the public. And one incident in particular helped to break the ice between the severe, minimalist structures and the notoriously emotional and fiery population.
I had a direct connection to the police desk. And the light went on as I'm driving to work in the morning. And the sergeant on duty says, Mr. T, we have a problem at the World Trade Center. I said, what is it? He said, there's a guy walking on a tightrope between the two buildings. What should we do? And I couldn't think of it. I said, tell him not to fall off.
The daredevil was a Frenchman named Philippe Petit.
Then I call back about 15 minutes later, and I said, you know, I've been thinking about it. I could use the publicity, so don't arrest them. But the city of New York police said he must be arrested. The judge called me after he had him in court, and he said, he's such a nice young man, what should he do? I said, just don't hurt him. So Philippe Petit was given a sentence. He did a free show for children, crippled children, in Central Park. He crossed the pond, if you would. And Philippe and I became very good friends.
The World Trade Center stood for 23 years without serious incident. Apart from a few small office fires and the odd jammed elevator, the buildings led an uneventful existence. Gradually, the floors began to fill up. And although it was never the most prestigious of addresses, numbers 1 and 2 World Trade Center, as the towers were officially called, began to worm their way into the hearts of New Yorkers.
By the time the terrible events of September 11th happened, I think most people had actually made a peace with the Trade Center as a piece of architecture. They may not have loved it, but they liked it. They saw it as a benign presence, as part of the landscape of New York, and expected and counted on seeing it forever.
The first terrorist attack on the towers took place on February the 26th, 1993. A hired van packed with hydrogen canisters and the equivalent of half a ton of TNT was driven into the underground car park beneath the complex. Although there was no vehicle access actually inside the towers themselves, the terrorists got as close as they could, parking the van two floors down, 6 feet from one of the subterranean walls of the North Tower. At 18 minutes past 12, the bomb exploded. Six people were killed and 1,042 injured in what was, at that time, the biggest terrorist attack ever carried out on American soil. The towers acted like giant chimneys, sucking smoke from the blast upwards through the stairwells and elevator shafts, which were full of people trying to get out. The intention had been to demolish the base of the North Tower and cause it to fall into the South. But the terrorists had not reckoned with the extraordinary strength of this tube of steel.
The bomb was a serious bomb, but in terms of a building of the scale of the World Trade Center, it was not a significant event in terms of the tower. Now, outside of the tower, it was another matter completely.
The bomb failed to demolish the towers because it exploded outside the perimeter wall. The blast merely bounced off and shattered several floors of the car park and a machinery space below. The next time the terrorists attacked, the outcome would be different because 8 years later, they finally managed to penetrate the tower's defenses. From this point on, the building's design meant that the collapse was inevitable.
BT, always working on new ways of bringing you together.
Come on, we've got to get to the co-op. We've got to get those deals.
Family-sized co-op prawn cocktail, now half price. Fresh topside of beef, half price at £3.89 per kilo. That's £1.77 per pound. Sumptuous co-op party, chocolate fudge roulade, half price. And Kingston Estate Shiraz, also half price.
Oh, crackers!
Co-op, there for you.
It's amazingly clear. It's dynamic and multifunctional. It's the high-definition flat-screen TV from Samsung. It's a world of clarity, and everyone's invited.
You can either buy an anti-aging cream that works on lines and wrinkles,
or one designed to work on pores, blotches, tone, texture, radiance, and lines and wrinkles.
Only one cream guarantees to reduce the appearance of all seven signs of aging, or your money back. Total Effects.
Not a difficult choice.
Total Effects from Olay.
No, I don't think I have a window for you today. I've got a feng shui consultant coming. That's him now. Gotta go.
Call me Zane. Let us begin. It's done.
When the first 200-ton airliner smashed into the World Trade Center, traveling at over 400 miles an hour, it seemed that the building had survived the attack. In fact, appalling damage had occurred inside, cutting off vital escape routes and starting the process by which the towers fell. British-born naval architect George Slay was on the 91st floor of the North Tower at 8:46 a.m.
I was on the phone, I heard a roar, looked out the window and saw this passenger jet coming towards the building. It was only about two or three plane lengths away from me at that point, and I didn't really have time to react. It was just, I saw it and then it was into the building.
George's office was just below the point at which nearly 200 tons of Boeing 767 had struck the tower.
Our offices are between the two arrowheads, and my office was particularly to the first three windows to the right of this arrowhead in this area here. It doesn't get much closer than that. My office kind of collapsed around me. One of my colleagues came rushing along to see if I was okay and offered to drag me out. I politely refused. I said I was okay and crawled out myself.
At 6 minutes past nine, as onlookers watched in horror, the second plane hit. Watching from the window overlooking the complex was the engineer Leslie Robertson's wife, Saltine C., who is also a structural engineer with the firm.
Well, after the first tower was hit, all of us were gathered around the windows on the north side looking towards the North Tower, which was burning, and I was standing by this window with lots of other people from the office when we saw this blue and red plane coming by and smash into the South Tower. And people thought it was a movie. You know, it was unreal. We were so stunned. Nobody believed that this was for real.
In the weeks and months that have passed since that appalling day, the complete set of plans and drawings that are kept in this office has been under intense scrutiny. These plans graphically illustrate why many in the building would not escape.
These are the architectural drawings of the World Trade Center North Tower, Tower A. And this is the 94th floor, which is very close to the floors of impact on the North Tower. And the plane came in from the north side, so broadside onto the core. The core is from here to here, and from there to there.
If an outline of the aircraft is superimposed on the plans, the true scale of the impact becomes clear. With a wingspan and length of 157 feet, the Boeing 767 must have devastated the central core. All means of escape were now blocked for those above the impact.
With the layout of the stairs, which are here, here and here, don't think that anybody above these floors would have been able to make it out, because the cores, the stairs are right in the center of the building here, and that's where most of the plane would have been.
The design that so ingeniously allowed the wide-open floor spaces had concentrated the elevators and staircases in the central core. For almost everyone above floor 75 in the South Tower or floor 93 in the North, there was no way out.
I think talking to some of the other people in our office, when we first went into the stairwell, the people who investigated the stairwells looked up and they could see that the stairwells were blocked above us. There didn't seem to be, there's a lot of debris there and there was nobody coming down from floors above us.
The lift shafts too would have been severed by the planes and tons of aviation fuel would have poured into them, starting fires throughout the building. Lift operator Kelly Badillo was in the North Tower when the first plane hit.
I think one of the elevators, the lower ones, I think the cables broke or something, because they just came flying down, shh, boom. You could hear them. You could hear a lot of the elevators, and then you could hear the wind, shh, like a wind tunnel. But a lot of the elevators came crashing down. Doors flying right open, boom, hitting the other side of the wall and everything.
Standing in the lobby, Kelly witnessed the destruction of the very system that had made the buildings possible in the first place.
One of them came down and they hit the floor, or it hit halfway or something. And the doors, one of them flew open and then people started coming out that elevator and they had their hair was on fire. You could see the smoke coming off their jackets and everything. And they just kept on running. Everybody just kept on running.
Although few people survived from above the impact points, that the buildings remained standing at all undoubtedly saved many more. The fact that they were designed to resist over 13,000 tons of wind pressure meant that they could not be knocked over. In a remarkably prescient interview given over 15 years ago, Charlie Thornton, now one of the investigators, considered the scenario.
Well, 13,000 tons is a lot of force. People always talk about an airplane crashing into a building. And in 1944 or 45, a plane did crash into the Empire State Building. But the largest aircraft flying today, at least commercially, the 747, fully loaded, is on the order of 300 tons. So if you think about a 300-ton element crashing into a building that's been designed to carry 13,000 tons, you can see that an aircraft crashing into the World Trade Center would probably not do anything to the major building. It could affect localized structural elements, could knock out a column, and there could be some damage. But as far as a plane knocking a building over of that type, that would not happen.
Since the Empire State accident had shown that a plane could crash into a New York skyscraper, the designers were forced to consider the possibility. Taking the example of a Boeing 707 passenger jet, one of a new generation of heavy civil aircraft.
The airplane we were envisioning was the largest airplane of its time, flying slowly and low, lost in the fog. In any event, we designed the buildings to take the impact of the Boeing 707 hitting the building at any location.
But the aircraft that hit the towers was a Boeing 767, heavier than a 707, and full of fuel and traveling fast.
The energy contained in an airplane or any other moving object is proportional to the square of the velocity. Double the velocity, and you have four times the energy. And so the energy imposed on the building by the 767 was very substantially more than the energy that we had assumed in design.
Although the impacts were far more powerful than had been considered, and the damage far more extensive than anything ever imagined, still the towers did not fall. The enormous weight from above was supported by the columns either side of the gaping holes. But the buildings were now stressed far beyond their design calculations, and the next phase of the tragedy would unpick what little strength was left.
And if anyone knows of any good reason why these two people should not be joined in matrimony, will they speak now?
Yes.
Stop. What are you doing? This bride is not ready yet. She needs to evolve for at least a couple of million years. Haven't you guys ever heard of Darwin? Look, you rushed things. Not so good. Now the Grolsch is brewed slowly. Very good.
Isn't that right, my furry friend?
Grolsch, we only let you drink it when it's ready.
Ashamed of your mobile? Then get this amazing Siemens SL45 on everyone 100 from 1 to 1. We'll find the right phones for you.
Heartburn, love. Try these.
A Gaviscon tablet turns into liquid as soon as you chew. It soothes and cools to put out the fire of heartburn and indigestion. It may surprise you. Gaviscon tablets. See what they'll do for you.
It's time to see what my friends at Asda have got for us this Christmas.
We're rolling back the price of beer like Carling 24-pack to only £11.98.
Get any two of these gattos
for only £3.
And any three of these for the party for just £5.
There's thousands of ideas at permanently low prices.
That's Asda Prize! Ho, ho, ho!
Go and play with Robson.
Thornton's, perfection in confection.
These were the biggest buildings in New York City. Each floor was one acre in area. And we're looking at this, and we see smoke issuing under pressure for at least the top 20 floors, maybe more. So you're looking at, if we're using the 20-floor figure, you're looking at 20 acres of fire.
Although the designers of the World Trade Center had considered the possibility of aircraft impact, it seems no one had calculated the effect of the fuel on the structure.
To the best of my knowledge, the considerations of the fuel in the airplane in terms of an explosion or a great fire was not considered. Now, we were not responsible for that aspect of the design, so I'm wrong, but I believe it was not considered, and further, I believe that had it been considered, it would have been proven to be impossible to deal with it.
As thousands of gallons of aviation kerosene burned, hundreds of firefighters were dispatched to the scene, although in reality, the sheer scale and design of the buildings meant there was little they could do to save them.
A typical firefighting hose team can extinguish approximately 2,500 square feet. That's an area 25 by 100. If you get two attack hose lines side by side, they may be able to extinguish about 5,000 square feet of fire. The World Trade Center floor areas were 40,000 square feet. They're building these high-rise office buildings with open floor design and creating spaces almost 10 times more than the area we can extinguish with hose streams.
The nature and severity of a fire depends on the type of material that is burning, and predicting what it will do to a building is the preserve of experts called fire engineers. Jonathan Barnett is one of the official team investigating the events of September the 11th.
We're going to demonstrate three different kinds of fuel burning. We're going to look at ordinary wood combustibles. This represents wood or paper burning. We're going to look at a small pool of kerosene, and we're going to look at these styrofoam cups, which represent ordinary furniture that you might find in an office, which are made up mostly of plastics.
Although all these materials burn at a similar temperature, kerosene and most plastics have a far greater potential to destroy.
It's the energy that's given off that's different. When you have a kerosene fire, it gives off much more energy, twice the amount of energy as a wood fire, the same mass of material, twice as fast. So it actually gives off four times the amount of heat in the same amount of time. That's the key parameter.
Any unprotected steel structure faced with a highly energetic fire can be seriously damaged, such as in this test carried out in 1995 by British Steel. In it, a large amount of typical office furniture was burnt to see what would happen to the heavy steel beams that supported the ceiling.
When steel is bare, when it heats up, it gets weaker. It's not that it melts in a fire. In fact, normal fires are not hot enough to melt steel. Even if you were, for example, to use an unusual fuel like kerosene, you cannot achieve temperatures hot enough to melt steel. But what happens is it starts to lose its strength. And as it loses its strength, it starts to sag. It becomes softer and sags and can no longer support the load.
This was the largest test of its type ever carried out, and it showed how unprotected steel can be distorted even by a normal office fire. But as is usual in steel buildings, the structural beams only slowly and progressively warped and sagged. There was no chance of a sudden collapse.
In over 20 years, I have not seen, until recently, a protected steel structure that has collapsed in a fire.
So what was the cause of the devastating explosive failure that happened to the World Trade Center? How did such a massively strong steel building suddenly give way and come crashing down to Earth.
I couldn't believe that actually it collapsed like the way it did. Like everyone else, it was totally out of your human capacity to digest it and absorb it. I was shocked as anyone else.
Professor Hassan Astane is one of the few scientists actually carrying out analysis of the twisted remains that lie in the scrapyard in New Jersey. He has been studying the condition of the steel columns in an attempt to find out what the collapse mechanism could have been. There are several clues that immediately point to a very specific and unusual scenario.
What you see here is actually very critical, very, very important. Perhaps this is the most important piece I have found so far. This piece comes from most likely Tower 2, where the plane went in and exploded. This is the inside face of back columns. So plane went in, exploded right here, and the explosion hit this surface. What you see here is, first of all, a bend that is due to explosion, but more importantly, this is a signature of explosion here. This has happened due to explosive material hitting this column and making that bulge. So this is the floor where explosion happened. And the windows are blown away, everything is burned, even fireproofing on this floor is burned and glazed to the steel.
The fireproofing in the World Trade Center was sprayed on, a dry, fragile material made of mineral fibers. Designed to protect the steel from heat, it appears that it may have been blown away by the blasts from the impacts. Although every piece of steel in this scrapyard would have been treated, very little of it can be found.
This piece, as you can see, has been burned. You can see the smoke and the fire effect on it. You can see some fireproofing, but really not much of it is left. So you can see that when the building was burning, there was no fireproofing left.
The lack of fireproofing would have meant that the steel was extremely vulnerable to the heat from the kerosene. But what has intrigued the investigators above all is that it may have had a disastrous effect on one particular part of the structure, the support for the massive open-plan floors. At the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, Professor Eduardo Causel has been carrying out research into the disaster.
In retrospect, and we can always play the general after the war, we can see what went wrong and what you could have done differently. And perhaps the Achilles tendon of the World Trade Center is the way that the floors were supported with the columns, the connection between the floors and the columns. It was in my view, these were relatively weak connections.
The floor system was unusual for its time. Instead of the thick steel beams that are normally used, the floors were supported with lightweight structures called trusses. A steel deck was placed over them to form prefabricated panels, which were then hoisted into position. They were fastened at each end to brackets welded to the wall. And once in place, each floor was covered with a 4-inch layer of concrete. This system was one of the reasons why the towers could be built so quickly, since each floor was largely pre-assembled down on the ground. But the drawback with such lightweight trusses is that they can be very susceptible to fire.
There is no other construction technique that has killed more firefighters than trusses. We have a saying in the fire service, don't trust the truss. They fail during fire. For example, 40 years ago, the fire protection engineers told us that an unprotected steel truss will fail within 5 or 10 minutes of fire exposure.
Trusses are highly efficient. They're extremely strong for their weight. But because they're so light, they heat up very quickly in a fire. And unless they're well protected with fireproofing, they will start to bend and distort. With the fireproofing damaged or removed altogether, this was the first part to be affected by the inferno raging in the towers. This computer simulation done at MIT shows how heating the trusses would cause them to fail.
What this simulation shows is that the most likely, the weak point of the floor were the connections to the supports. And it might have started failing at those locations first, either the external connection to the columns or the internal connection.
The heavily distorted brackets in the scrapyard suggest exactly the same thing to Professor Astonay.
You cannot bend the steel like this without cracking it, unless you warm it up. So what this piece tells me is that this piece was very hot when the floor collapsed and bent it. So that must have been the initiation of collapse of this World Trade Center tower.
As the floors began to fail, the last terrible phase of the destruction started. For the efficiency of the design meant that with any major element removed, the whole structure would fall. The reason why is best demonstrated with a simple wooden model.
We have here two frame structures. Basically, these are the columns, and these are three floors. And I'm certain that we had fires, and these fires caused this floor basically to fail and drop onto the floors below, underneath. So once this floor was gone, we had a situation similar to this one here, where this intermediate floor disappeared, basically dropped. This changes dramatically the way in which the loads in the building are carried. Let me illustrate this by adding weights here to this structure. And this load, again, that I just added, is transmitted through these columns all the way to the table. The important thing to understand is this floor does not carry any of this load. The only function of this floor is to connect the columns together, to tighten the columns together, and prevent them from buckling.
The model on the left is able to take a very large amount of weight, but the one with the missing floor is only able to support a quarter of that amount before its columns twist and buckle, and it collapses. This is the mechanism that almost certainly caused the collapse of the World Trade Center. The fire destroying the floors that kept the walls standing. After burning for 53 minutes, the South Tower collapsed in 11 seconds. Thirty minutes later, the North Tower crumbled. Once it was underway, nothing could stop it. By the time the tops of the buildings had fallen just the height of a single story, they had gathered enough momentum to smash each floor in turn, accelerating until all 500,000 tons hit the ground at 120 miles an hour.
People would ask me, did it sound like a freight train? I said, no, it didn't sound like a freight train. It sounded more like a freight train that was derailed. It was a loud series of booms, similar to the way a train would be when it was derailed, if it's hitting the railroad ties. So it was like boom, 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 like that.
The World Trade Center was an extraordinary building that faced an extraordinary attack. It now seems that its daring and innovative design hastened its own destruction.
I'm a human being. I have trouble sleeping, and I It's very tough. It's very tough to be the structural engineer for a building that, collapsed and killed a lot of people. It's very tough.
Is there anything